Seven Secrets from Hindu Calendar Art by Devdutt Pattanaik. Chapter 4. Shiva's Secret. Withdrawal leads to destruction. Part 2. This image here shows various events from Shiva lore, drawing attention to his transformation from the hermit to the householder. Shiva's first marriage was a disaster. His wife, Sati, was the daughter of a priest, Daksha. Sati followed her husband everywhere, accepting him for who he was. But her father found her choice unbearable. Shiva's ascetic ways did not appeal to him. And so, when he decided to perform a sacrifice, he invited everyone to partake of it except Shiva. Furious at this insult, which Shiva did not even notice, Sati killed herself at the sacrifice. In rage, Shiva beheaded his father-in-law after destroying his sacrificial altar. Here, he played the role of a conventional destroyer, destroying a social order that made no sense to him. This event is the first to show Shiva responding to an external stimulus. By following Shiva, the goddess as Sati makes Shiva care for her so much that when she dies violently, he is filled with emotions of outrage and a desire for vengeance. For an ascetic who refused to open his eyes, this is a huge transformation. This image here shows Shiva carrying the corpse of Sati, weeping like a lover. After the death of Sati, Shiva once again withdrew into his cave, and the gods once again conspired to get him married. They sent Kama, the god of desire, to shoot his arrows at Shiva. But rather than being aroused, Shiva killed Kama with a fiery missile sent from his third eye. Shiva, who had experienced the turbulence of emotions because of Sati, was not going to surrender to it once again. Sati was reborn as Parvati, princess of the mountains. She prayed to Shiva. She meditated intensely, forcing him to leave his cave and come before her. "What do you seek?" he asked. "You as my husband," she said. Her determination and devotion was so great that Shiva had to agree. Thus, Shiva connected with the goddess not out of desire, but out of grace. She induced him to become benevolent. With this, he became the householder. He became Shankara. This image shows Shiva as a groom, making his way to the house of his wife-to-be. Being a hermit, he did not know how to dress or behave like a groom. He came drunk, smeared in ash, with an entourage of ghosts and goblins. Across the Himalayan region, there are many folk stories of how Shiva's marriage party terrified the local residents, and how, looking at him, Parvati's mother Mena, wife of Himavat, the king of the mountains, begged her daughter to reconsider her decision. Finally, Parvati begged Shiva to accept worldly ways and be a more presentable groom. He indulged her and became a beautiful god, Somsundara, as beautiful as the moon, and married the goddess. The story draws attention to how Shiva, or the soul, does not discriminate between the beautiful and the ugly, between man and ghost, between cows and dogs. While this is a very lofty concept, this does not make sense within the social framework. In society, there are standards and values. There is the good and the bad, the beautiful and the ugly. There is the right and the wrong. There is, in other words, judgment. Judgment is impossible without standards. For the hermit, these standards may seem cultural delusions, but for the householder, these are essential cornerstones of civilization. This image shows the power of Shiva now put to worldly use thanks to his marriage. With his eyes opened by the goddess, he is open to responding to the cries of the world. Once, the gods churned the ocean of milk for Amrit, the elixir of immortality. While doing so, a deadly poison that threatened to destroy the whole world emerged. No one had the power to consume the poison. So the gods approached the one form of God that does not distinguish between poison and elixir. Shiva indulged the gods, consumed the poison, and saved the world. While Shiva the hermit could consume the poison, Shiva the householder could not be allowed to have the poison as part of his system. So the goddess clasped Shiva's neck, restricting the poison to his throat. The poison remained there, turning his throat purple. Thus, he is also known as Neelkant, or the one with the blue throat. At another instance, shown in this image here, in response to the prayers of a young devotee, Shiva stopped Yama, the god of death, from killing a youth, Markandeya, who was fated to die at the age of 16. Shiva overturned fate, reinforcing his status as god, a force that is greater than fate. When the river goddess Ganga descended from the heavens, he caught her on his head and trapped her in his hair, thereby absorbing the shock of her fall. He then released her slowly, making her spring out of his topknot. This river gave life on earth. When their ashes are immersed in this river, the dead are enabled to be reborn. The river represents the material world that on the positive side offers the chance of rebirth, and which on the negative side breeds sorrow by constantly changing. By controlling the flow of the river, Shiva symbolically takes the role of the yogi, one who is able to control the mind so that it is not a slave of matter. These three stories indicate the transformation of Shiva to Shankara. Married, he is worldlier. He saved the world by drinking poison. He bestows longevity and he helps the dead to be reborn. It is said that the moon was once cursed with a wasting disease, and so it took shelter on Shiva's head. Contact with Shiva helped the waning moon wax again, for Shiva is the source of all potency. That is why the crescent moon is always shown on Shiva's forehead. This image shows Shiva dancing. This posture is the famous Tandav, which essentially means the more aggressive masculine form of dance, distinguishing it from Lasya, the more enchanting feminine form of dance. In this form, Shiva transforms into Nataraj, the lord of dance and theatre. This is a peculiar dance, which he performed once when sages saw him walking naked with an erect phallus. Like most people, they did not see his eyes were shut and assumed he was aroused by the sight of their wives. They tried to attack and kill Shiva. In response, Shiva danced. In this dance, he raised his left foot above the ground and pointed to the moving left foot with his left hand while standing firm on his right foot. As mentioned in chapter 3, Ardhanari's secret, the left side is the side of the material world, while the right side represents the spiritual world. Shiva is Ekpada, he who stands on one foot. He stands on his right foot because he is firm in spiritual reality. He indicates that our fears and insecurities emerge because we do not understand the nature of material reality, that it is transient, that it arouses and it depresses. It is the realm of rasa, stormy waves of positive and negative emotions. This image here shows Shiva's son, Kartikeya. The story goes that the world was terrorized by a demon who could only be killed by a six-day-old child. To create such a powerful child, the gods needed the help of Shiva, who, being an ascetic, had never shed semen. And this, according to traditional belief, had rendered his semen very potent. This was one of the reasons why Shiva's marriage was necessary. Shiva's semen, released after his marriage, was incubated by Agni, the fire god, by Vayu, the wind god, by Ganga, the river goddess, and by Sarvan, the forest of reeds, so that a six-headed child was created. He was nursed by the six Kritika stars and prepared for battle. Though a child, this divine warlord led the armies of the gods to victory. The story of Kartikeya's birth must be contrasted with the birth of Ganesha, as retold in chapter 1, Ganesha's Secret. Kartikeya is born of Shiva's seed and incubated by six material entities, which are fire, wind, water, reeds, stars, and finally, the goddess herself. Hence, Kartikeya has six heads, as seen in this image here. Ganesha's body is created out of the turmeric Parvati anointed her skin with, and is finally completed when Shiva replaces his head with an elephant's. Both sons represent the union of god and goddess, with the god taking the lead in Kartikeya's case and the goddess taking the lead in Ganesha's case. But in both cases, Shiva is an unwilling participant. He has to be forced into fatherhood. Thus, The spiritual wants to disengage itself from material reality, while material reality wants to enchant it. This tension between the two generates the force that propels life. Like Shiva, Kartikeya's relationship to marriage is ambiguous. In the north of India, he is considered to be unmarried, while in the south, he has not one, but two wives. Here too, marriage is a metaphor for engagement with material reality, with society. Kartikeya's wives, as shown in these images, are more popular in South India. They are Devasena, daughter of Indra, the god of the sky, and Valli, the daughter of a local tribal chieftain. Thus, the ascetic son is wedded to the sky and to the earth. In many ways, this relationship is similar to that of Khandoba with his wives of various communities discussed in the image on the left, and of Balaji with the local princess Padmavati discussed in the image on the right. Thus, through Kartikeya, the transcendent metaphysical Shiva is localized and made more accessible in the hills of the south where he is mostly worshipped. In North India, it is said that Kartikeya did not marry. The reasons are not clear. After the competition between him and his brother, as described in Chapter 1, Ganesha's Secret, it is said that in rage, Kartikeya refused to look at the face of any woman, even his mother. That is why in the few temples of Kartikeya in the north, no woman is allowed to enter the shrine. Kartikeya even left his father's house to stay away from his mother. He moved south, but soon began missing the northern hills. Feeling his son's homesickness, Shiva ordered a Rakshasa or demon called Hidimba to carry two hills from the north to the south. These hills are now pilgrim spots where Kartikeya is said to reside. In the south, he is worshipped either as Kumara, the bachelor, or Subramaniam, the married god. This image here shows two crisscrossing triangles. This is a geometrical representation of the union of material and spiritual reality. The upward-pointing triangle, like a mountain, represents stability, stillness, and God. The downward-pointing triangle, like a waterfall, represents instability, movement, and goddess. When they are separated, they look like Shiva's rattle drum, as seen in this image here. But when united, they form a six-pointed star. Several such six-pointed stars are below the goddess in this image here. These are yantras, or geometrical communications of metaphysical ideas. The same geometrical form is rendered in three dimensions in this image here. This image shows the Shivling. The upwardly protruding pillar is conceptually the same as the upward-pointing triangle. Both represent Shiva's erect phallus as he lies prone on the ground. The trough below, on which the pillar stands, is conceptually the same as the downward-pointing triangle. Both represent the womb of the goddess as she sits on top of him, as implied in these images here. Thus, it is the union of the changing truth of matter, shown by the downward-pointing triangle representing the yoni, and the unchanging truth of the spirit, shown by the upward-pointing triangle representing the linga. Pots without stable bases hang on top of the Shivling. The base is punctured so that water drips continuously to remind us that worldly life is about movement and life ebbs with each passing moment as water flows out of a broken pot. We have to use this finite time we have with us to discover the truth of spirit and matter. How when they engage, there is creation, and how when they disengage, there is destruction.
Jab chaho on ho jao. Epic on chalao. Available across all devices.